Miracles in Buddhism. Miracle is a very important word for religious people. By using this term, they can arouse human emotions, ignorance, illusions, imaginations, and inquisitive mind to introduce their religious belief, because many people are ignorant. They cannot understand reality, facts in life, or the nature of the world, worldly conditions. Since they have their own imaginations, religious people try to take the advantage of this ignorance. When you study the life of the Buddha and the Buddha's attitude toward the so-called miracles, you can understand that the Buddha was not interested in miracles. He did not depend on miracle to introduce Buddhism. He did not encourage his disciples to show any kind of miracles to introduce Buddhism. But he could perform any kind of miracles. But he did not try to take the advantage of this illusion. It is an illusion to influence others' mind to accept a religion. The reason is, having seen, having heard that some of his disciples have done this, performed miracles to influence others, the Buddha condemned, criticized, saying, if you try to introduce Buddhism through your miraculous power, people may come and follow, join, for curiosity's sake, but they never realize, they never try to understand the Dhamma, the teaching, to cultivate their way of life. So there is no reality. Once he has said, by performing miracles, if you try to introduce people, to bring more and more people into Buddhism, it is more or less a young girl who performs a very beautiful, very attractive dance in front of the public. Even without any clothing, naked, there is no doubt thousands of people come and assemble and admire, enjoy that dance. This is the Buddha's attitude towards miracles. You can bring people into your religion, but they never learn religion. They never try to cultivate their morality, to lead a respectable and noble life. So don't depend on miracles. Many people try to introduce the Buddha by talking about his miraculous power. To understand the nature of enlightenment, wisdom, if we try to recognize, to understand the Buddha through his miraculous power, it is just like a person who is inside his house peep through the crack of the wall in his house and try to see what is happening outside. We can see how much he can see through that crack. So don't depend on miraculous power. Then certain disciples ask, in that case, what type of miracles that do you advise us to perform? Now this is very important. Then the Buddha said, if anyone can educate and enlighten a cruel person who endangers the society, who disturbs, who bluff and swindle to lead a noble life, a respectable life, a holy life, that is the real miracle. You can understand the Buddha's attitude. To change that person's mind to be noble person, then he has pointed out certain incidents. Angulimala, number one murderer who has killed more than 1,000 human beings. Terror, gangster, bandits. How? The Buddha tamed him. And how he followed the Buddha and become a monk and who led a holy life, in the end become an arahant. That is the real miracle. Alavaka, a cannibal who lived on human flesh. The Buddha approached him. He tried to kill the Buddha also. But he had the courage and knowledge and compassion and wisdom to train and tame this devil, this cannibal, to become a noble man. It is a miracle. There are few hundred incidents during the Buddha's time how he performed this kind of miracles. After all, what is a miracle? When we cannot understand how certain things really happen, we cannot imagine, and then we say it is a miracle. Take for instance, David Copperfield, isn't it? You have seen how he has gone through China Wall. To you it is a real miracle, because you cannot understand how he does it. So one day, when you come to know the trick, you never take this as a miracle. When a person come and perform certain things here, magician, in the eyes of small children, all those things are real miracles to them, because they cannot understand. But to some of you, although you really cannot understand the trick, you know it is a trick. There is no reality. This is the nature of miracle. Our senses are very limited. Our thinking power is very, very limited. Simply by using these limited five senses and thinking power, we cannot understand certain incident happening. And then at once we say, oh, it is a miracle, miraculous power. I remember certain miracles that people performed or accepted as real miracles in this country a few years ago. This is the advice given by the Buddha for us neither to accept nor to reject anything. It's a very good advice. Whenever certain things happen, the Buddha says, don't accept at once that it is true. At the same time, don't reject, say, oh, nonsense, I don't believe it. Think, take time for you to understand. Now one day you'll come to know what it is. Remember this advice. Don't allow your emotion, without using your sense of reasoning, without using your common sense, to accept anything, whatever people come and talk about that person or that person, he can perform miracle, he can cure any kind of sicknesses, you believe at once. So what happened? Few years ago, in Klang, suddenly, from an isolated area, the water started sprinkling like a fountain. People could not understand how this water come out from this. Then they believe that this must be a miracle. Then people started coming with bottles and buckets and cups and collected water and drink. After drinking, they spread the news. They have been suffering from this sickness, that sickness, and this and that. Now they feel very much better. Then more and more people started coming. Muddy water actually, not clear waters. Whenever we take something with devotion, confidence, that mental energy, that mental attitude change so many things in our physical body. So devotion or faith and confidence for the time being. Some changes take place. So if you take anything with great confidence, you can see immediate result, good effect. Just on for the time being, because of your devotion. Then, a man who wanted to find out actually what is the cause of this, he came and started to dig. After digging and digging and digging, he found out underground there was a rotten pipeline. Old one, very old pipeline. It burst from there. The water started coming up. When people came to know this news, no more miracle. That miracle is gone. If that person did not discover this, even today you accept this as a miracle. This is the nature of miracle that many religionists use to bluff others. Another one. I don't know whether you can remember. A few years ago, we had a miraculous chapati. You know chapati? Indians and Bengalis, miraculous chapati which can cure, especially cancer. And one of my friends, Indian friends, also come and introduce me to take. It's very good for your heart. You can get rid of your heart trouble and problems and diabetes. Ask me to take. So what happened? They bring one chapati and keep in a plate in the evening and pour some tea, water, hot tea, into this chapati. Next day morning, you can see three layers. Miracle. Because at night time, the God come and multiply. Yes. And then they try to introduce their religion also, through this. Before you eat, you must thank God and reciting this prayer, then you can get rid of your sickness. Spreading all over the country. Then, one doctor at the university hospital, all these are real incidents, not made up stories, who wanted to find out what is the secret of this chapati. So what he did, he collected few chapatis in the evening and poured coffee into one, milk into another one, tea into another one, cold water into another one, hot water into another one, and kept like this. Next day morning, he went to see. Only that particular chapati in which he poured tea multiplied, but others still remain as one. And then he analyzed tea. There is something which contains nicotine, or what do you call, not nicotine, something there in that tea which multiply this chapati. But coffee or hot water or milk or cold water could not do that. When this news item, it appeared in Malaysia. When this news item appeared in the newspaper, that miracle also gone. A group of people were meditating at night time while holding a religious meeting. That is interreligious. This happened nearly 3 years ago in this country. So what happened? When they were sitting there, thousands, suddenly the light is gone. Very dark. They do not know what to do. Then they ask their respective religions. They have a Buddhist, Christian, Hindus, and all sort of religious people to recite prayers. So group by group, they went on praying. No. When one particular religious group started to pray, within few seconds, the light appeared. Then someone has seen. Somebody was doing something with the switchboard at that time. Found out the secret miracles. And this is the way how they try to introduce miracle. Now I can tell you, because I came from another country, you do not know anything about me. I can tell you, I was born in a Christian family. I have been praying to God for many years. I had an incurable sickness. Went on praying to God. No cure. One day one of my friends came and asked me to pray to Buddha. Believe me, after few weeks, that sickness completely disappeared. That is why I decided to become a monk. You believe that? And this is the way how they try to introduce. All those miracles are like. They can show, you see, among the followers of our religion, people are not suffering from these sicknesses because they follow this religion. Then we also accept it. Now you can understand why the Buddha did not encourage. Don't depend on miracles. Then you can ask whether there are miracles according to the Buddha's teaching. Whether the Buddha and his disciples could manage to perform miracles. Yes. Answer is yes. When you study the life of the Buddha very carefully, you can see there were certain occasions the Buddha had to perform certain supernatural, unusual power. When he come to know that simply by teaching, advising, he cannot train, he cannot enlighten this person. Example, Angulimala, that murderer, was a terror. He wanted to catch the Buddha by raising his sword to cut him. He started running, chasing after him. The Buddha walked in a normal way, without running. This man started running and running and running and running by using full speed. But he cannot reach, come nearer to the Buddha. The more he run, the more he goes behind, cannot reach. But this man cannot understand what is happening. Now he cannot run anymore, he is tired. Then he asked the Buddha to stop. Then he knew this is the time to talk to him. Because he is such a strong, dynamic young man, he knew it is impossible to train him simply by advising. Allow him to run and run and run until he gets fed up. Now then he says, stop. The Buddha says, yes. Do you know, I have stopped long ago. You are the one who runs. Then he says, what do you mean by that? How can you say you have stopped? I saw you are also walking. But I did not run, isn't it? Ah, yes, it is true. Then he asked, what is the secret? What is the reason why I could not catch you after running more than 3 miles? Then the Buddha said, do you know why you could not catch me? Because you run. If you stop your running, you can catch me. He could not understand. Then he explained. Running means by committing all sorts of evil and wicked and sinful things, the person prepares a very long journey in samsara, running and running and running, endless. Birth and death and birth and death and birth and death, running. That is the meaning of running. You are doing that. I told you I have stopped. I have stopped all these bad and wicked and harmful things. And I have stopped this journey, this birth and death, no more for me. That is the meaning of saying, I have stopped and you are the one who run. It has become a real miracle to this young man. Yeah, can I follow you? Why not? And then he became a monk. After that he led a holy life. So it is a miracle. But he never tried to show this unless he come to know that simply by preaching that he cannot open his mind. This is one of the extraordinary characteristics in the Buddhas. There are six kinds of characteristics which we cannot find in any other religious teachers or any other arahantas or any holy man, only in the Buddha. So one of them is, by knowing the mentality, understanding capacity, the nature of the mind, how far this person can understand, and how this person had prepared his background, life after life, how he cultivated, how he developed, trained his mind. The Buddha is the only one who can understand this. So before his preaching, he surveyed and studied the mentality of all these people. That is why directly, just like giving an injection, he can approach and point out certain things which influence, affect and open the mind to understand. That is the secret why many people attain sainthood, arahanthood on the spot, instantly, because of this. But many others preach blindly, not knowing what they can understand, whether they like or not, whether they can appreciate or not. That is why they cannot gain anything. So in the case of the Buddha, he always studied the nature of the mind, then taught. So when he come to know simply by talking, it is impossible for this person to open his mind to understand. Then he performed this kind of minor supernatural power for that person to open the mind. When he opened his mind through that supernatural phenomena, then start to preach. And that is the technique. He had so many techniques according to the mentality, character, temperament, mood, attitude, education of all the devotees. Then how do they perform miracles from the Buddhist point of view? There is no divine power behind these miracles. Not through the influence of any god or deva. It is pure psychological. The development of the mind, psychic power. When a person practices meditation, especially Dhyana meditation or Samatha meditation, this particular technique is to develop the mental faculties to gain some sort of supernatural mental power. So after gaining this supernatural mental power, they can show certain things which others cannot understand, others cannot do. So they think these are miracles or supernatural powers. They can disappear suddenly and reappear somewhere else. It is true. When they develop this mind creative, then they can fly like a bird. They can walk on the water. So one day, when the Buddha was going somewhere, he met a man who had practiced this meditation for a long time near a river. Then he told the Buddha, "Do you know, I got that some supernatural or miraculous power through my meditation. Now I can walk to cross the river, walk on the water." He was very proud about his achievement. Then the Buddha asked, "How long did you practice this meditation to gain this power?" He said, 25 years. The Buddha says, "Utter wastage. Wasted your life for 25 years. An ordinary man can cross this river by spending 25 cents, paying to a boatman to take you to the other side of the river." And this is the Buddha's attitude toward this kind of miracle. To him, there is no religious value. Do you know, Devadatta, the Buddha's cousin brother, a monk, who gained this miraculous power, can appear and disappear, transform himself to appear as devils or ghosts or birds, transform, miraculous power. So when he wanted to gain power, worldly power, he influenced and misled another young king, King Ajatasattu, persuaded him to kill his own father so that you can rule the country. I'll kill the Buddha so we too can rule the whole country by using miraculous power. That a stupid young prince accepted his advice. And he tried to kill the Buddha by using miraculous power. Because they gained this miraculous power without developing purity in the mind. By keeping their anger, their craving, their selfishness, their jealousy, they can develop this mind, that mental energy, to gain this supernatural power. Then what will happen? They can misuse and abuse this power for gain worldly things. Very dangerous. This is one of the reasons why the Buddha did not encourage. To him there is nothing. Then how do we gain this? We do not know the nature of mental energy. Mental energy is the most dynamic, strongest force in this universe. It is true. All the other existing dynamic forces were discovered by this human mind. Handle, manipulate, by using this human mind, either for constructive or destructive purpose, diverted by using this human mind. Now we can understand how powerful it is. Now we are wasting for nothing. That is called ignorance. We do not know the value or the dynamic force or how to divert our mental energy without wasting for unnecessary things. Through our five senses, every day, how much mental energy that we waste. Through our imaginations, how much energy we waste. If you know how to accumulate and harness this energy, then this mental energy becomes the most powerful energy that we can divert, direct to do anything in this world. Example, there's a big waterfall in a jungle. You can see every day the water pouring and flowing. Wasting. An engineer, having seen this waterfall, decided to build a dam to collect the water without wasting. Then he tried to pick the hydroelectric to supply electricity, can illuminate the whole country and can support those farmers for cultivation, channel proper manner without wasting this water, that energy, in the same manner. If you know how to divert our mental energy without wasting for unnecessary things, our mind can, we can develop our knowledge, our courage, our understanding, our wisdom, our energy. Now we are hopeless. We are powerless. We surrender ourselves to any stupid man. We believe anything because we have no more energy, mental energy, wasted. You know how to accumulate this. Then unnecessary fear that we maintain in our mind never appear anymore. We are scared of so many things for nothing. Shameful, actually speaking. We disgrace our human intelligence. Scared of this, scared of that, for nothing. Imagination. Because no power, no energy in our mind. And we have no strong determination in our mind. Very vague, wavering. Because mind is weak. If you know how to use this energy, you can develop that to maintain courage, to face any problem, to overcome so many problems, to avoid so many problems, instead of going and praying to this God, that God, this devil, this ghost, and burning this and that, throw away all this rubbish, develop your energy, mental energy. So when you go pray and pray and pray and pray, that clearly shows you have no mental energy at all. All wasted. One who knows, one who can understand, can throw away all this rubbish. Try to understand. Where are the mistakes? What is the cause? Who is responsible? Instead of worshipping and worshipping and burning and burning. So we are not behaving as real human beings, actually speaking, because we do not know how to develop mental energy. All the other existing religions in this world advise human beings to surrender themselves, surrender their mind to somebody, and pray and pray and beg, that's all. What did the Buddha say? What is his attitude? It is not necessary for you to surrender to anybody. It is not necessary for you to go and beg. There's nothing you can gain from outside. You must know how to make use of your own human mind. When you develop this human mind, you can conquer the whole world. He said, I could manage to conquer the whole world, not by praying to any god, worshipping, not by reciting any mantras, not by performing any rites and rituals, only by developing and cultivating my mind. Pure mental energy is there. Buddhism, the Buddha's teaching, directly emphasizes towards human mind. Unfortunately, we have very strong ignorance. We do not know how to make use of this human mind. So when we develop this, anything whatever we need, whether it is supernatural power or supernatural living beings, to gain anything, if you know how to make use of the human mind. The Buddha has introduced the method how to do that. That is called Buddhism. Buddhism means the method introduced by the Buddha for us to use our human mind. Remember this. Without abusing, without disgracing, without insulting our human mind. By maintaining our human dignity, we can stand as gentlemen. If we really follow the advice given by the Buddha, then what will happen? The unnecessary fear that we have in our mind all disappear, no more. Suspicion we have in our mind due to lack of understanding also disappears. Because of our imaginations and ignorance, we maintain this belief, oh, devil, ghost, a spirit, hantu, God, create all these problems and troubles, but this stupid mind cannot understand our human mind is responsible for all these problems. That is what the Buddha said. We have forgotten the first tensor of the Dhammapada in the Buddha's day, Mano Puppangama Dhamma. Our minds are responsible for all these good and bad happening, occurrences, incidents in this world. So if we know how to guard, how to protect, how to utilize, how to make use of this human mind, then we can see a peaceful, happy, prosperous world life. Without doing this, what we do? We go and pray and pray and pray and worship and worship and worship. Never try to develop, never try to purify, never try to cultivate our own mind. We want somebody else to come and purify the mind. If you are cruel, if you are jealous, if your way of life is harmful or dangerous, you can go and pray, I am very wicked, please take away my wickedness, I want to be a good man. Do you think there is anybody in this world, any God or any Buddha, who can take away your cruelty from your mind unless you make up your own mind? It is your work. You have to decide. You have to determine. You must understand. Then, slowly, you can withdraw your weaknesses, then cultivate and replace with kindness and sympathy and understanding. And this is the method taught by the Buddha. This is called Buddhism. So Buddhism is not for us to depend on miracles, not just to go and pray and pray and worship, but to live as cultured, harmless, respectable human beings. That is Buddhism. Without doing that, whatever we do, there is no real religious life. So do you want to cultivate your miraculous power to appear and disappear and do some bank robbery? That is what many people want, to develop this meditation and get supernatural power, suddenly disappear and appear inside the bank at night time. Just like Devadatta, what he did. So don't depend on miracles, my dear friend. As I mentioned, when you develop our mind, we can, or naturally, I can give an example. This happened in Sri Lanka, I think more than 1,500 years ago. A monk who had developed his meditation and meditation and meditation and developed this miraculous power. By using this miraculous power, he can create anything in this world. If anybody asks him to create anything, instantly he creates. There you are. He had a disciple, a monk. He also learned meditation from his teacher. But the teacher is cleverer than, sorry, the disciple is cleverer than the disciple, the teacher. He went on developing. He has attained the highest stage of sainthood, arahant. After attaining his arahanthood, the disciple wanted to find out whether his teacher also attained the highest stage or not. Now then he realized, actually, teacher has not developed further after gaining this supernormal or supernatural power. He stopped thinking that he also gained the highest stage. Then he came to see the teacher and asked, "May I know whether you have attained the highest stage of sainthood or arahanthood?" Then the teacher, "Why not? How can you prove?" The disciple asked, "Well, I can create anything in this world. Do you think an ordinary man can do that?" Then the disciple say, "Okay, very good. Now, can you create a huge elephant in front of you?" "Oh, very easy." Instantly, there you are. Huge elephant is standing there. See? Very good. Disciple says, "Very clever. Now, can you ask this elephant to come and charge, attack you?" "Yes." Now, then he asked the elephant to come in, and now the elephant is coming, raising the trunk. When the elephant come nearer to this place, the teacher said, "Got up and let run away." Then the disciple asked, "My dear teacher, you said you are an arahant. Do you know arahantas have no fear? If you have attained arahanthood, why do you want to run away?" So it clearly shows you are not an arahant. Then the teacher realized his weakness. From that day onward, he tried to develop further and further. Later he also attained it. This is the danger of miraculous power. When we gain something supernatural, we think we have attained the highest stage and nothing, no more. Stop. But later again we drop. Drop from all these things. Now Devadatta, who developed that miraculous power, everything is gone. Because he has become a very cruel person, so according to Buddhism, he is in hell now, he is suffering. Because of the wicked, dangerous thing that he has committed. So, miraculous power is not the solution for us to be religious, to be noble, to find out our salvation or to lead a religious life. Only our understanding. Our understanding, our character, our way of life, how far we can maintain our goodness. It is like this. To understand this, I can tell you, when others doubt you, if you can trust you, that is more than enough. Can you understand it? All the others doubt you, but you trust. That means you have no guilty conscience in your mind. You know you are correct. You know you are right. That is enough.